and welcome to the Good Deeds program, a quarterly update at a look at your registry of deeds. And joining me, we are recording this program in late August. The Register of Deeds for Norfolk County, Bill O'Donnell, is with me. Bill, welcome back.
Mark, thanks for having me, and thank you for the Access Television for hosting this.
Well, this is I think this gives a good sense to people who watch about activity that not only here in the city of Quincy, but throughout the county, really.
Well, certainly part of it is, part of what we're doing at the registry, and our principal function is to record documents, community land record documents, and we love talking about the statistics of what's going on. And then we've also tried to make the registry relevant. It's the biggest asset most of us have are our homes, and with different programming and different things we do. So it's always good to come and talk about different things.
And there's always something new. You're working on a new project almost constantly, so we'll get to some new happenings at the registry throughout this program. Talk first about real estate activity here in the county and here in Quincy.
Well, sure. Just in the month of July, the prognosis has been, it's been sort of flat, and the real estate brokers you talk to say that there's not enough inventory of homes to sell. The interest rates have gone up a little, and that has people a little, troubled. And for some people, they've never seen interest rates at 17% or 8% for the those of us who may have bought houses in the 1980s, these interest rates are really low. But, so when they creep up a little to people that have never seen high interest rates, it can cause, kind of a slowdown of the flatness. And certainly mortgage lending countywide and here in the city of Quincy has been down. So we looked at 7 months worth of volume, and that certainly has been down countywide. The total documents recorded is down 4%. And mortgages countywide are down 13%. So the lending activity certainly is not what it has been. In some communities, though, for instance, a community like Quincy, and there's other communities around the county, things are up. In Quincy, deeds are up 15% for deeds that involve a purchase price, and for all deeds, which sometimes involves transfers into a trust or into another individual, it's up 11%. So there are communities that sort of are bucking the flatness trend. There are communities that it's still a hot market and there's activity.
And as we assume that interest rates will continue to kind of tick up.
Yes, and that's going to have a factor. It might give someone pause. They might be in a house where, they might want a bigger house, but interest rates going up, that costs money over a 30-year mortgage. People might still remember 2008, 2009, where there was a robust activity, right through, 2002 to 2006, and then things happened. And I think, maybe people, will still be a little reticent to buy a bigger house, for some people to get into the market in the first place, because they might be worried about the economy or the fact that maybe are they going to keep their job. So, but a lot of the brokers right now are saying there's just not enough inventory, which is when I say flat, that's volume, but sales prices are up, and that's because with inventory being low. I hear brokers saying they have 10 people competing for that one house, some of these offers are over asking and things like that. So when I say flat, I'm talking about document volume, people a little concerned about the interest rates ticking up, and just seeing what the numbers are. The numbers are not up. But other indicators like sale price, if that's your indicator, sales prices are up.
Well, let's look at that. In Quincy, average sale price is $561,944, countywide $7,007. 430.
And again, some of those numbers get skewed because it's not just residential, it's commercial, and some of the communities like Quincy have, you know, a bigger, you know, commercial base. But there's also activity here in Quincy. So, you know, but the sales prices are up because, you know, we see that relative to the collections at the registry. So,
the other side, foreclosure activity.
Well, foreclosures, you know, countywide foreclosure deeds, which is the end of the process, they were up countywide 8%. There was 153 when we looked at January 1st, 2016 to July 31st, 2016. In the same period in 2017, it's 165. So foreclosure deeds are up. That's one of the reasons. Hey, even if there's one foreclosure, it's probably one too many, that we're very fortunate to have partnered up with Quincy Community Action Program and NeighborWorks of Southern Massachusetts, where they are available, they are nonprofit, and they try to give people help that are struggling with foreclosures. The good news in Quincy, in 2016, there was 12 foreclosure deeds, and there were only 10. So the numbers in Quincy, but again, one is probably one too many, but please take advantage or go to our website at www.norfolkdeeds.org. We have links to those, you know, great community, nonprofit community groups that will give you some advice, give you some counseling, will help you out of the situation. And it's the good news is there's what they call notices to foreclose. That's the beginning of the process. And those numbers are down. It's in countywide, it's down over this 7-month period from January 1st to July 31st. It's down 28.5%. So there was 338 notices to foreclose in 2017 compared to 473 in 2016. So that's the good news. That's the, you know, that shows people that people are struggling, but at least the percentages are going down. And again, in Quincy, there was only 37 notices for this 7-month time period in 2017 compared to 43 in 2016. So, you know, so foreclosures are there, and it's something we never tracked. We only started tracking that in 2008 and 2009 when I said, well, wait a minute, this is becoming an issue. Let's start really looking at it. So, you know, it's good to track the statistics, but that's one statistic I wish was zero, but it's not.
Let's talk about electronic recording. And I'm just going to go over this point for the folks at home. Approximately 40% of recorded land documents recorded electronically each week at the registry. That seems like an awful lot.
It is, and it didn't start that way. By way of history, we started electronic recording of recorded land documents. There's two types of lands at the registry, recorded land and registered land. And on the recorded land side, again, it was when I first started as register, a technological advance, electronic recording, no one knew what it was, correct, you know? So there's all kinds of things that have come up, and we've tried to make it relevant at the registry. And when we started doing electronic recording on the recorded land side, it was 1-2%. And it just shows you how that's grown. And the reason why it's grown is a lot of the registry users, be it lawyers, law firms, institutional lenders like banks, find it very efficient to do their business in their office. And then through electronic recording, which has been authorized by the federal government, the state government, send it over the internet and get it recorded. They find it more efficient. They find it really helps them with respect to delivering good customer service on their own. So that's why you see more and more people doing it. We love people coming down 649 High Street. I'd like to think that I want to keep it a people business. I love having the people come in and record. But we just make it, hey, we have people doing electronic recording whose office is right down the street in Dedham. Yeah. They find it that efficient. Well, and it's been expanded. Now we're doing it in the land court. And again, the land court, we had to get authorization from the state government that would allow us to do it. They had to make some changes in the law. And we started in April. The legislation was effective in April. And then in July 1st, we went to doing purchase and sales deeds. So we're doing it all now on the land court side. And the percentages started smaller, but it leads me to believe that will grow as well. But we're just making it available, using the advances in technology to make the registry, at least relevant in this modern day and age.
Well, that's exactly what I was thinking. This day and age, the immediacy is amazing, and people expect it.
Well, they do, and I like to think we're fortunate. I have a great staff, but a lot of the things we started to put in place, became registered in 2002, have put us ahead of the curve, because now it's not enough. For some of the registries, they only go back 20 years worth of documents on the internet. We go back to 1793 to book one, page one, the very first document recorded. You can look up. Our indexes, some people have, some other registries have 30 years worth of index on. We have indexes back to 1900 that are totally integrated. And I would say by the end, maybe the next time we come in and talk, that will be fully integrated, because we are done with the index from 1793 to 1900, but we've just been trying to double check and perfect it. And to keep in mind, when I started as register, we still print books at the registry. The first book that I was involved in was in the 17,000s. We're over book 35,000. So in my tenure since 2002, we've printed over 18,000 books. All those books have been indexed. The only books that haven't been indexed, book 1 to 861, and they've been indexed, and they'll be rolling it out. So when you say people expect it, I, as an elected official, expect it too. We try to put in place these initiatives because, we want to be the best registry in the state if we can, and I think we are. And I think it's taken a lot of work, but it's also driven by what you said. People expect it, and it's not just the professionals. The principal people we deal with. Sure, it's a part of our economy. If people can't rely on the records, houses aren't being sold, businesses aren't being developed, real estate development isn't taking place. So our principal function is to be part of an economy, the real estate economy, that's not only big here in Quincy, it's big regionally, it's big in Massachusetts, it's big nationally. But other people now are using the records, whether it's genealogical research, historical research. I always say Norfolk County is the county of presidents. Four presidents were born here. So there's a lot of other uses of the registry besides just the strictly professional real estate oriented.
Sure, there's the history component. Buff.
Oh, and there's plenty of history. I've been trying to do this project, Notable Land Records, and we're going to get to it, but electronic recording comes along, or we're transcribing the documents. But I love history, and one of the projects we've been doing is Notable Land Records. And it started because, four presidents were born in Norfolk County. But what I'm trying to do is look at cultural figures, political figures, athletic figures, people of note, and see if we can tie it into a land record. Helen Keller. Out in Rentham, Mr. Rosenberg, Dunkin' Donuts, Howard Johnson's. There were, of course, governors and cultural figures. Mary Pratt from Quincy. So we know about historical people. Hal Holbrook in Weymouth was an actor. People probably say, "Who is he?" So I'm dating myself. But
I know.
There's a lot of, like you said, historical, and we're trying to. Make it relevant. The Supreme Court justice lived in Dedham, so we're trying to, there is a lot of history in Norfolk County.
Well, the oldest part of the country, really.
That's one of the reasons we just completed, it's kind of timely, the end of July, we completed our transcription project. We started doing just deeds, and we've expanded it. We've transcribed over 445,000 documents. And what I should point out to the listeners is from book one, which is 1793, to 1900, which is book 861, the documents were transcribed. They didn't have typewriters. I guess the register in 1900, when he was going around, that was his modernization initiative, the typewriter, and they started typing the documents out. But it was all cursive, very hard to read, I don't know how history can come alive if you can't read the documents. So the professionals like it, the people that use it for the real estate economy, because we've transcribed the documents. The legal document is the handwritten one, but it's helped people that use it professionally. But it's also helped for people, again, historical and genealogical. We have a lot of great information in there. We have some of the deeds list all the things from 1799 that were in that house. You get a sense of what a house was about.
Right.
You know? And you have some interesting, deeds in and of itself from a, historical nature. You got, Paul Revere and, over in Canton, of course, in Quincy, there's plenty of history between John Adams and John Quincy Adams, So the transcription project has been a way to make history come alive. And it's not our principal function, but again, I try to look for projects, whether a notable land records or the transcription project, that we can just, do things that make the registry relevant. It is an arm of government, I always say, that no one really knows about. But the biggest asset we deal with are our homes, and that's what it's really about. But we have a lot of history here, and I think it's good that we get it out there.
Let's go back to homes and talk about mortgage discharges and how important it is to make sure that your mortgage has been discharged, if you believe it has been.
Yes, that we all borrow money. We all need to borrow money. We have kids in school or trying to buy a house, and a mortgage gets recorded. The lenders that lend you money want to make sure they get paid. But when those mortgages get paid off, you want to make sure a mortgage discharge gets recorded. And, there's been lawsuits and things like that. The Attorney General's office has been involved. And I think there's more sensitivity to it. But for a while there, a lot of the mortgages weren't getting discharged, whether they weren't getting to the registry, or sometimes banks would send it to the individuals, but not make it real clear that you got to take that original discharge to the registry and get recorded. So the reason you want to do it is, it's been paid off. You could have refinanced to get a lower rate,
right?
Or take some equity out of your property. So you paid that mortgage off. You just want to make sure the mortgage discharge gets recorded, which tells the world that that's been paid off. Because you don't want to be getting that call the week before the close and saying, hey, there's a mortgage. Well, that was paid off 20 years ago. Well, we need a discharge. And it becomes problematic. Yes, I'm a big believer in community banking. If you can go to that local, Colonial Savings in Quincy, or Norwood Co-op in Norwood, the local, community banks, you'll get good customer service. They'll go down, look it up. Oh yeah, here's your discharge. Make sure you take it to the registry and get recorded. But some of these banks have merged. Some have gone out of business. So we have links on our website, again, www.norfolkdeeds.org, where you can, we have links to the Massachusetts Division of Banks. We have a document, Where Has Your Bank Gone?, which gives you some federal and state contact information to try to track down where has your bank gone if you have to chase that mortgage discharge. So it's important to have. It can be a lot of work, because people forget some banks went out of business in the 1990s. So it's what we attorneys would call a title issue. And sometimes the title issues are a lot more trickier to solve, and you just want to make sure you get on it right away. So you'd rather do this stuff before you're under the gun of selling it or refinancing your property. So always, and you can use our website to check the discharge. We have computer seminars where we bring people into the registry and teach them how to use the computer, or you can go on your website from your home and see your mortgage, and you can abstract it to see if it's been paid off.
One of the other issues, one of the other safeguards that was put in place by the legislature here in Massachusetts was the Homestead Act protection. The level of protection. It used to be, now it's automatic. It used to not be automatic. However, there's an automatic level of protection against your house, and then there's added protection that could be, simply added. And first of all, talk about the Homestead Act. It is important. You talked about the person's home being really the single most important investment
Well, homesteads mean different things in different states, but here in Massachusetts, the legislature writes the homestead law, and it allows people that own their house as principal residence. It doesn't matter, you know, you could be lucky enough at 18 to own the house. You have a right, as long as it's your principal residence, to declare an estate a homestead. Now, your local legislators here in Quincy and in Norfolk County, you should thank them, because Massachusetts, for the first time, has an automatic homestead. It never had that. Before, you had to take some affirmative steps to get homestead protection. And what does it do? It protects against the forced sale of your home. You know, it doesn't protect you if you don't pay your mortgage or if you don't pay your taxes to the federal government or to the local government, but it does protect you in certain things, and it sort of puts a picket fence around the home that they can't force the sale of your house. Now, when I first started as registrar, it was $300,000, but again, thank you, local legislators, it's been increased to $500,000. So for me, it's great that it's automatic, but the automatic protection is only $125,000, and it gets apportioned according to, you know, who owns it and things like that. For me, the filing fee, again, set by the state legislature, is relatively modest. A homestead is $36. For $36, I'd rather get the added protection, which is now up to $500,000. And it is a consumer issue. I think it's a consumer right. It's a consumer protection. And I think more and more people are taking advantage of it. And even I mentioned how the statistics show it's been a kind of a flat for 7 months, kind of down. Countywide, homesteads are up 5%. And in the city of Quincy, homesteads are up 18%. So certainly programs like this and other outreach programs that take place, it's getting out there that, hey, you know, take the time to put a homestead on. And the legislature has expanded it. Before, if you had the property in trust, you were barred in the land court anyway by a case that said you couldn't put it on. But now it's been expanded to trust. It's been expanded. People that own mobile homes or manufactured homes have a right. The legislature has given them the right to come to the registry, even though they might not own the underlying land, to record a homestead on their mobile home, for instance. So there are protections that people should consider, and hey, it's well worth, you'd rather do it proactively than when you're under problems.
And talk about elderly.
Yes, again, the legislature defines elderly as 62 and above. So, you know, they've written the statute a number of different ways, but someone's considered elderly if they're 62 and above, and they have their own, you know, special homestead that they can put on pursuant to the legislation. And again, thank your legislators. And it might be good to use our internet too, because what people didn't realize, when you refinanced, there was language in there that a number of attorneys would argue terminated your homestead.
Good point.
And the legislature has just, you know, made it clear to people, look, if that language is in there, it doesn't terminate your homestead. But it depends when you refinance. So the good news is the legislature is listening. The legislature is looking out for the consumer as far as homesteads go. But it's just something that the consumer should check. Hey, wait a minute, when I refinanced, did I terminate my homestead, you know, before this legislation took place? So.
And are you at 125 or are you at the full amount?
Yes. You want, for me personally, I remember when I refinanced and I saw the language in there, I tried to get it canceled, but you know, hey, you know, there's attorneys on the other side too, you know, and I just put another homestead on because I didn't want to, I didn't want 20 years from now someone to say, hey, when you refinanced when your kids were in college, you know, you terminated your homestead. I didn't want that problem. So
check it out.
Yeah, check it out, because it's well worth having, and hopefully you never need it, but it's a protection that the legislature has given you a chance to avail yourselves of, and I think it's every consumer that owns a house should put a homestead on.
Let's talk about another consumer-related program, and that's the notification service.
Sure. We're very proud of the anti-fraud, kind of property service we have. And one of the reasons we did it is the FBI is out there telling that property fraud, mortgage fraud is one of the biggest, you know, white collar crime.
Yes.
And What we've done is, it's very simple. If you go on our website and go to the Consumer Alert, it's a consumer notification program, you can just sign up in your name, and if something comes across in your name, you get an email. Now, we haven't seen the fraud that has taken place out the West Coast, out in Illinois, but it's only a matter of time. There's all kinds of frauds, as we see between credit cards and deed scams and things like that. But we haven't seen any fraud where, you know, property has, you know, deeds have been signed and things like that. And if there is, you know, we the courts can take care of it, the police can take care of it. But what we're trying to do is get you aware of it as soon as possible. So you sign up for this notification. I have personally done it. And I get an email. If a William O'Donnell, a document comes through a William O'Donnell, it shoots me an email. Now, it might be William J. O'Donnell. It might be William F. O'Donnell.
Probably
I'm William
a popular
P. O'Donnell.
Name.
Well, all I do is I get an email. I look it up. It's not me. For me, that is not inconvenient. That is just the price of staying on top of things. Now, there's going to be a time when that William P. O'Donnell comes in, and maybe it's my deed. Well, wait a minute. I didn't sign that.
Right.
And then we have links to the law enforcement agencies in Norfolk County that you can go to and say, hey, wait a minute. That's not my deed. Now, again, we're just trying to be proactive, and it's a way to use the internet, hopefully in a positive way. And I think it's a way to be proactive to give people in Norfolk County who own property here just another layer of awareness so that bad things don't happen to your property.
You did mention earlier about computer seminars, so I'd like to end this program on the availability of these seminars. They're taking place, as you had mentioned, right at the registry.
Yes, and you know, check our website. We pride ourselves, of opening up the registry. We open it up to the general public. I believe we're going to do it October 17th. But check the website, where people come in and we just kind of give a class. It's very hands-on. We have computer terminals sprinkled throughout the building, and we, you know, have handouts, and people kind of learn the ins and outs of some of the things we just talked about. And we're also doing another one that's geared to government officials, to people that work in the town and city halls, because, you know, a lot of those individuals use the registry website and use it for work. Other people should, you know, just want to use it to kind of, you know, better themselves as far as knowing what's going on with their particular property. So, yeah, come to the registry. It's a beautiful old building, 1903. It was built downtown Dedham at 649 High Street. We'd love to have you come by.
And just in closing, I just want to congratulate you because you have been named Register of the Year by the County Registers of Deed.
Yeah, no, it's good to get recognized. I mean, it's been a busy year. I mean, we did that land court legislation that became effective in January, and we see the effects of it. And then I think the transcription project was another big project. No other registry in Massachusetts, for that matter. I guess they say New England has done it. So it's good to get recognized, but we have more work to do. And But I'll put it up there with that Quincy Community Action
another award.
Yeah, right next door at the desk. Yeah.
Well, thank you, Bill, for coming in, and we will touch base next season. But thank you for giving us an update.
Yeah, thanks, Mark. Thanks for having me.
You're welcome. Thank you for watching. You have been watching a program of Quincy Access Television. Please continue to watch QA TV for more locally produced programming.